my name is Zoe Briggs and welcome to Buckingham News. To pee or not to pee? That is the question at the centre of the long-running drama of where to site public lavatories in the town centre. Just as it was thought that the curtain was coming down on the saga, Buckingham Town Council had its plans rejected by Aylesbury Vale District Council. Are they clean round the bend? Michael Pearson went to find out.
In Gabrielle Chevalier's novel Cochemaul, the residents of a small French town find themselves embroiled in a row over a public urinal. Shift the setting to Buckingham and the plot remains the same. After raising the £125,000 required and receiving a verbal agreement from Aylesbury Vale District Council for the plans, town councillors were shocked that the District Council had made the decision not to grant the permission for the land.
It's a poor show. It's not what councillors should be doing. Councillors should be acting within the public's best interest. I don't think the public's best served by cancelling toilets. That's for them to answer. They've got to go along to the public and convince them of that argument.
Besides this, it is very clear that the area at hand is not suitable, as the toilets would open out onto a busy road and an entrance to a car park which would not be suitable for disabled people or parents with children.
The main priority is whether people can cross on that corner safely or not.
There was a secondary proposal which was suggested.
The secondary proposal is just behind me. There's a piece of grass there which has some shrubs on it, which we are pretty certain is just AVDC land. So at the moment we're trying to establish there is no right of way over that piece of grass.
But with this talk of in-town loos, do people really need more toilets?
Yes. There's a good shortage of public toilets. The ones that they have got, they're not pleasant.
The ones up there keep being vandalised up the high street, so you can't use them. Or there's always junk in them. It's not on.
I would never take my little niece and nephew in there, and also they're the only public toilets, and we need more facilities because when the community centre's shut, there's nowhere else for people to go.
Whole areas are developing, there's more houses, more people coming in, for older people, also people with children, there's just no facilities whatsoever.
Out of all these talks, it is clear Buckingham needs new toilets and they can no longer beat around the proverbial bush. This is Michael Pearson for Buckingham News.
And it's not just downtown that loos are making news. Sarah Cordes is desperate for a wee in the CRB.
The ladies' lavatories in the Chandos Road building have been closed since last vacation as part of the medical school building works.
While a refurbishment is welcome, this means that hundreds of female students who use the building each day have to use the building's single disabled lavatory.
It's really inconvenient because we only have one ladies' toilet in this Chandos Road building.
Honestly, I feel it's uncomfortable because there are no mirrors and there are only one ladies' toilet for use.
I think people should be allowed to use boys' toilet instead because we don't have enough spaces.
The university administration maintains that the provision of lavatories is compliant with Workplace Health and Safety Welfare Regulations 1992, but a closer inspection of Building Standards 6465 shows that this idea of compliance is based on rules for provision for facilities for employees rather than for a building with many visitors who use the lavatories at concentrated times such as between lectures. Section 6.8 of the regulations, which are available to the public, reveal how wholly inadequate the current provision is.
This table here shows that for 1 to 5 people in the workplace, you need one cubicle. As we're a university, we need more facilities than that.
Health and Safety refused to give an interview due to there not being an issue with the facilities, but the building works go against building standards.
It looks as though Health and Safety have written their rules on toilet paper for us to flush away. This is Sarah Cordes for Buckingham News.
Despite its popularity, last week's charter fare was far from a thrill ride for some Buckingham residents. Closed roads and cancelled buses left many people screaming out of frustration rather than enjoyment. Dan Morris has the story.
Charter Fair is a place to come and enjoy an assortment of rides and funfair food. The bus cancellations and road closures in the High Street and Market Hill has caused a large disruption to the people in Buckingham.
Well, our business is run from the Town Hall, which is opposite where the fair is sort of set up. So they close it from about 12 o'clock on the Friday, which means traffic can't go through the centre. I mean, Buckingham's quite lucky because there's a bypass around it, so there's other options and other routes, but it just gets more congested in the centre, really.
The fair has affected me quite a lot, I guess. Trying to get into the other side of town takes a lot longer than normal, and it's just a bit of a hassle to drive up and around.
The worst thing is when the lorries come through. That's probably a bigger problem.
As the Charter Fair only comes 4 days a year in the October month, it is a quick period for families and friends to come down and enjoy everything. However, this year, it did not live up to the traditional four-day-a-year event. This year, it was only open for 3 days. Event coordinator Amanda Brubaker explained the situation.
Okay, the Charter Fair comes into Buckingham on the first Saturday after the 11th of October. It comes in on the Friday. It arrives in town and sets up sort of in the morning, and then it's only allowed to operate on the Saturday.
The fair ending last Saturday, the road and bus schedules have returned to their former arrangement. Hopefully there will be less chaos and disruption following the next annual Charter Fair. This is Dan Morris for Buckingham News.
The devastation in Gaza was the subject of a public lecture organised by the University of Buckingham's Amnesty Society on Monday. Palestinian journalist Youssef Al-Halou examined the humanitarian situation, the reconstruction of Gaza, and his own personal campaign, Resilient. Philip Joss went along to find out more.
Gaza has been the centre of conflict for more than four decades after Israel captured the settlement from Egypt in 1967. Whilst Israel withdrew troops in 2005, the conflict is far from over as sea, air and land blockades continue Palestinian suffering. July saw the longest period of violence in Gaza yet, when the killing of three Israeli teenagers triggered a 51-day-long war. 2,104 people were killed, 69% of whom were civilians. Whilst a truce was declared, two attacks last week have postponed peace talks once again.
I'm hopeful at the end of the day, one day we will see a light at the end of the dark tunnel. But not for the time being. Hopefully our children, they will see it one day.
I think the West can do more for Palestine, not only Gaza, because it's the duty of the international community to find a just solution to this problem.
Could you tell us more about your charity, Resilient?
It's an effort to draw a smile on people's faces. It's nothing compared to the bigger charities or international NGOs, civil society organizations who try to help. So, we have a duty to do whatever we can in order to alleviate the suffering.
So whilst there is still a long way to go for Gaza, with charities and awareness campaigns like Resilient, there is still hope. This is Philip Joss for Buckingham News.
In other news, the Law Society elections were an anti-climax yesterday as the committee walked into their new post uncontested. Chi Ing will be taken over from Alex Katz-Nelson as president, and Tasnim Meyer steps up as her vice president, replacing Rayif Andrews. The new committee will serve 6 months in office and will be announced formally at the Law Ball this evening. Aylesbury Vale District Council have given planning permission and listed building consent to convert two historic town centre properties into an 11-bedroom HMO or house in multiple occupancy. The Grade 2 listed building is located on Well Street. The HMO will be aimed at the student rental market. No changes will be made to the ground floor commercial unit on 25 West Street. However, there is no parking available for residents. The University of Buckingham Centre for Extractive Energy Studies held a roundtable conference in the Radcliffe Centre on Wednesday. The focus of the conference was to discuss the current legal and political issues in the African energy industry. They were joined by noted experts in the African energy sector, such as Mr. Wale Tinubu and Mr. Abimbola Ogunbanjo. Not all businesses survived their first year, but Curious Minds Vintage in Buckingham celebrated that milestone this week. Alex Biddle went to see what they're doing right.
Small businesses don't always last, especially in a small town like Buckingham, but Curious Minds have different plans.
The shop on Cornwall Place sells a variety of old, quirky, and as you would have guessed, vintage items. And the locals love it. even joining the shop for its celebration for its one-year anniversary this week. They gave out free cakes and drinks to customers, and best of all, they gave a 15% discount on everything. Curious Minds Vintage are known for their direct and engaging attitude towards their customers, keeping them updated on their Facebook page and website. We wondered whether this had anything to do with their success.
I'm a bit impulsive, right, and I've been wanting to I've been wanting to get into the vintage thing for a long time. I've worked in vintage before, but for other people, and I wanted to do my own thing. So I went self-employed, and I realised that actually it probably would be good to have a base. It just so happened I found a business partner who was willing to join me, and it just all happened from there. I didn't even think about it, I just went for it. The one.
And why do you think your shop is popular, especially with students?
Oh, I don't know. I didn't even think about it, to be honest. I don't know, I get a little bit of everything for everyone. I'm hoping that, you know, I'll get a good variety in, try and make it as fun as possible, always trying to think of new things to keep people interested. I think that's the best thing you can do, really.
Curious Minds Vintage has beaten the odds and survived its first year, and with the fun and friendly atmosphere that the staff have, it looks like it's not going anywhere anytime soon. This is Alex Biller reporting for Buckingham News.
And now, over to sports with Leandra Behrens.
Thank you, Zoe. The University of Buckingham Football Club were looking to prove themselves once more after a 5-2 loss in last Saturday's match against the Oakley Reserves. With Buckingham currently 10th on the table, next up were Hanslope Reserves, bottom of the division. John Arcada went along to see whether the Unileds could regain some momentum.
The Buckingham boys looked confident as they walked onto the rec, and 14 minutes in, Hayes Abinouzo put in a powerful run up the centre for Buckingham's first real attempt on goal, but failed to keep his feet neat, allowing Hanslope goalkeeper Chris Amar to gather the ball. 2 minutes later, Abinouzo had another crack from the edge of the box, just going wide. Constant Buckingham pressure kept Hanslope in their own half, but players including Jan Oxenschlager and Shannon Birchall lacked an assured first touch, and too often, the ball ran into touch. Hanslope's frustration showed itself in a two-footed, studs-up lunge by forward Paul Pugh, resulting in a yellow card. George Hatswell took the kick, but Buckingham couldn't capitalise.
On 24 minutes, some neat passing put Abinouzo in a scoring position, but he blazed wide.
Hanslope got a look in when a looping corner eventually found Jamie Clarkson, who found the power but not the precision, a story repeated with a free kick 2 minutes later. After a foul on Shannon Birchall, Hatswell's free kick wasn't far off. On 33 minutes, Buckingham found the net, but Adekunle Oyekun and Fire's combination was judged offside. A minute later though, Fire broke through to strike home one that counted. Just on half-time, Buckingham had the chance to widen the gap, Abinouzo's shot being spilled into Fire's path, but again, it was ruled offside. The second half began scrappily, but there was more of a sense of fight from Hanslope. Pressure from the men in orange forced Camillo Irigui into giving away a penalty. Clearly aggrieved, Buckingham goalie Dean Rental snatched the ball from the spot, earning himself a yellow card for dissent. Pugh converted to equalise, 1-1. With both teams visibly tiring, the game ground on to the end of its natural life. Buckingham 1, Hanslope 1. Buckingham are ninth in the NBDFL Division 1 with 10 points. They'll have to raise their game if they want to escape mid-table ignominy. This is Jala Kader reporting for Buckingham News.
Last night, the University of Buckingham's netball team travelled to Bletchley to face local side the Breezers in their third game of the season. Leila Zadin travelled with them looking to continue their good run of form.
The Buckingham girls indeed brought the heat last night, but was it hot enough? They implemented quick ball play and agility to match up against the Team Breezers with their height advantage. The game of four quarters tested the Buckingham girls' passing technique and ability to look for the space. However, goal attack player Jenny Savage led the way with her consistent shooting. In the first quarter, the Buckingham girls were in excellent form with a 6-3 lead. And to follow into the second quarter, Four more goals were scored, making it 10-7 to Buckingham. In the third quarter, the Team Breezers had another advantage with fresher players due to having more substitutes on their team, whereas the Buckingham girls lacked energy, which provoked them to panic throw without precision. In the last fight of the final quarter, the Buckingham girls lost to a tightly score of 14-15. The game was indeed a great lesson for the Buckingham girls to ensure a hard comeback for next week's final game in the league. This is Leila Azadeen reporting for Buckingham News.
That's it for sports. Now back to the studio.
Halloween is fast approaching, and it isn't just costumes that set the mood. Get out your cauldrons and join Holly Knowles as she stirs up some creepy cocktails.
With Halloween on Friday and many parties to be enjoyed, we've created two new spooky cocktails for you to try.
To create a Devil's Kiss Punch, you will need to add 250 ml of cranberry juice into a cauldron, 100 ml of white wine, and 25 ml of martini. Then shake into a large shaker. If you prefer a cheeky cocktail for your angelic side, then try Bloody Gore. Pour 100 ml of lemonade into a shaker, along with 50 ml of vodka, 100 ml of orange juice, then shake rapidly.
Oh, that'll make you scream. Whether you want a trick or a treat this Halloween, these cocktails will terrify your guests. This is Holly Knowles for Buckingham News.
Thank you for watching Buckingham News. We'll see you next week.